Hello and welcome to our show. This is From This Corner TV, and I'm Marilyn Dayton, your host and producer, back with another wonderful show for you. Remember, the reason we're here is not just to entertain you, but also to educate you and to talk about things that interest you. So we've got a very interesting show. We're going to be talking about from life to acting to writing books. And we should all think about writing books. We're going to talk about that. Joining us is our co-host, Dodie Millardo. Welcome back.
Thank you for having me back again.
And we're very excited to introduce you to Ruth Crocker, writer and publisher. But oh, so much more. You're going to learn that today. Let me tell you a little bit about her. Ruth grew up in a nursing home, family business. Performed as a singer, actor, and storyteller while maintaining a career in clinical nutrition and healthcare administration. She does a lot of things at once. Today, she's a published author and loves teaching the writing process, especially with aspiring writers who have personal stories they would like to share. Ruth, welcome to our show.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. This is great.
Well, I've been wanting to get you on the show actually for quite a while, and I think the timing is right, and you'll find out what I mean in a couple of minutes. But let's back up just a little bit, and let's talk about that family business and the nursing home. And I know that you have said on your website that that was an early education on grief and resilience. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, my family started in the nursing home business in the 1940s. And so I was born in 46, so I was born right into it and didn't really know any other life except being surrounded by a lot of older people who I actually thought were my relatives when I was growing up, because we actually lived in the nursing home up in Old Mystic for a period of time. But it was normal life. It felt normal to be surrounded by older people in different stages of, you know, cognition and physical health. And people died, and people generally didn't graduate except through at the end of life, but. Mm-hmm. It was just a very rich experience, because also it wasn't just that I was with caregivers who were taking care of people. My parents were very dynamic. They were, you know, my father was in World War II. He came back, and my mother and grandmother had started this business, and my father jumped in and was renovating the building and doing all that sort of work. And they were, my parents and my grandmother and grandfather were, they were musicians, they were funny people, they were also, you know, hardworking, and so it was, and they, we just pitched in as kids. I had three brothers, and it was just normal. I remember when I was about 7 or 8 years old, reading Christmas stories to, you know, people in the nursing home, and then trying really hard to memorize them so I wouldn't have to read them from the book. So
that storytelling was the beginning of what became part of your career. But the storytelling must have gone both ways. You probably heard some stories from the people there at the nursing home. Didn't they share their stories with you too?
Yeah. Especially, those people who were able to share stories. Mm. But I think where the real storytelling happened was kind of around our dinner table, because my mother didn't really stop ever being involved with, when she would be working all day as a nurse and then come home and we'd have dinner, and then she'd be talking about, you know, Mrs. Smith, Mrs. Work. Lamb, and stories of how they got to the nursing home. And I remember back in the 1950s, a story about a man who had been brought into the nursing home, and she said, we were giving him a bath, and we thought we were getting down to skin, and we were just getting down to the second layer of long underwear. So, and she told the stories with a lot of, affection for the people that she was taking care of. So.
And so this opened your eyes to a lot of things.
Oh, yeah.
To patience with people, respecting older people, and the process of grief and dying and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. That's quite a lesson for a young person to live in.
Yeah, yeah. And you experienced and witnessed a lot of the grief and the sorrow and all of that, but I can't imagine how, and even going through all of that and understanding all of that, how it could have prepared you for losing your husband in the war in Vietnam. Now you wrote a book basically about this, right? And so how did you cope with that? Did some of the experiences that you had in the nursing home, did that help you to cope a little bit? I just can't imagine.
Well, I think, besides the nursing home, I had a younger brother who was an invalid at home about the age of one. And my grandmother, who was very dynamic, had a stroke by the time I was 10. And so they were at home in our house being taken care of.
Right.
And my younger brother died at home when he was 7. Mm. And that was really, and I was 14. And that, watching how my parents coped with that was really what informed me, I think. I think that's really mm-hmm. where we get our really core experience is from just observation mm-hmm. of those closest to us and how they manage mm-hmm. things. And
wow.
So when my husband was killed, I was actually living at home with my parents because he was in Vietnam.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I remember that, it was, my parents were just, they were totally grief-stricken because they loved him too.
Sure.
And I described that in my book. And I think I just, it was like the family just, they embraced me, but they didn't put pressure on me to be anything. I remember being up in my room and just being thinking about it over and over again, mm-hmm. the way you do when you have
sure.
an experience like that. And my family was, they let me do what I needed to do, and I did some pretty dramatic things, because I ended up, taking his ashes to the Eiger in Switzerland. And my parents never questioned anything.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure they worried about me, because I know after becoming a parent myself, I know how much we worry about our children. But
mm-hmm.
but I think that's where we really learn how to survive mm-hmm. with this kind of experience. And the one thing my mother told me was, which I hated when she would say this to me, which she would say, time heals all wounds. And I absolutely hated to hear that, because I didn't want time to go by when, mm-hmm. After losing him, I didn't want to go into the future.
Mm-hmm.
But she was right, eventually.
Well, the thing is, it heals, but it still hurts.
There's a scar still.
Yeah.
There's still
you never really
an effect
get
from it.
Over that.
Well, you get more, you get stronger, and you hold it in a different way. It isn't bombarding you in the same way,
mm-hmm.
the terribleness of it.
It's not like what they say, an old story that gets in the way of making new stories in your life.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's something that you have to go through and own totally and completely
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
in order to get through to the other side. But a shadow of it still follows you,
mm-hmm.
No matter what.
Mm. But what really healed me, I wouldn't say healed me totally in the sense of, letting it go, but just transformed me, was back to the idea of storytelling, was when I met by chance my husband's comrades in 2006, and they told me stories about him. And so I would say the, you know, their stories just brought him back. And that's what we want. When we lose someone, we want to carry them with us. And there were years and years when I thought that the only people who remembered him were me and his family and my family. And, you know, I didn't have a sense of the larger world, you know, that people get forgotten. But
what prompted you to write about it?
Well, writing is very, it's a very healing...
Cathartic, yep, very cleansing.
Cathartic
very,
experience, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's, and for me, writing was really a compulsion. I writing was something I had to do. When I was going through even the early stages of losing Dave, my first husband, I remember writing things like over and over again, the same words. Everything returns, which is a line from Siddhartha. Just, it made me feel better to, you know, pull my feelings out. And he had been, both of us had, a lot of our life was writing letters to each other because he was gone so much in the Army.
Yeah.
And so that just was very healing to keep writing. And as I... And also my son, from my second marriage, he knew the whole story about Dave. He knew the family. They treated Noah like a grandchild, mm-hmm. like their own grandchild. And Noah actually kept encouraging me. When he was in high school, he would say things like, Mom, Spielberg has gone out and collected all the stories of the Holocaust survivors, and they're going to be, you know, all gone soon, and you're not going to live forever. You should write this story.
So, sounds like a teenager.
Yeah. Yeah.
But how right he was.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because yeah. Look what happened. This is what caused you to write Those Who Remain.
Yep.
Right? Is it one of the things? Please hold it up so we
yeah,
can...
And, it's a little hard to see, but you can see there are letters on the...
Yeah, you did something interesting with those letters, didn't you?
Yes. When Dave was...
That?
Yeah, when he was killed, I had hundreds of letters. And when I was faced with what to do in terms of a funeral, and I was 23, so, you know...
So young to be going through that.
But you have a lot of wild ideas when you're... So I thought I could do anything. So I organized those letters and our clothes, my wedding dress and his uniforms, and I buried them in the coffin instead of him. And then he was cremated and
you took the ashes.
I took the ashes. But it gave me, you know, it gave me something. That's the other thing about dealing with grief is I think you have to feel like you have some control over something.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was my little piece of the world that I could control, was to manage, you know, the funeral like that. And but that was basically a secret, except, you know, my family knew and Noah knew eventually. And that idea of doing that as a way of, you know,
coping
yeah. and also it being a tribute to him, because he was a great outdoors person. He loved climbing and, you know, mountaineering, and so his sister and I, you know, took him to the place where he would really have wanted to have been.
And that makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, being aware of someone who they really are, it's very important, even though it's a sort of closure.
Mm-hmm.
In a way, and it makes you feel good
mm-hmm.
to deliver him to a place that he would enjoy and love. We don't all do that. We think of ourselves rather than the other person. So what happened to these letters later?
Well, I have to say, I was on your website, which is
www.ruthcrocker.com.
Okay, mm-hmm. And I saw the trailer for this, and when I first saw that you put those letters and your wedding dress into the coffin, I had to make sure I heard that right. You know, I had to go back and reread that and re-listen. if you get a chance, please, please go on and take a look at this trailer. It's fabulous.
It's the name of the book.
Yep.
On YouTube.
Yep. Yeah. Yep. Oh, it's on YouTube. It's not on the. I guess there's a link.
Oh, there's a link on my website to it. Yeah, you can click on it.
But at any rate, it was it's fabulous. So I'm sure the book is even better.
Yeah, and it was so. It was actually the anniversary. It was 5 years ago on November 1st, All Saints Day, that we did this. Because I, as I was telling these stories, as I began writing the story about what happened. Mm-hmm. A lot of people said to me, well, are you going to dig up those letters? Are you going to dig that up? And that had never occurred to me. When I did that, it was for eternity. That was it. Mm-hmm. And so finally, after I met the guys who told me the stories about Dave and how much they loved him, and they started, and I told them the story of what I did, and they said, well, you've got to dig that up because we want to know what he said about us in those letters. So they were all cheering me on, too. And they're like my brothers now. I get together with them about every 18 months and all over the country and these reunions. And so they know the whole story, too.
And but, did you say you met them by chance?
Well, Dave's brother was just Googling his name on the internet in about 2005, and he came up with all these tributes to his brother. Mm-hmm. And the things like, I would never have survived Vietnam if it wasn't for Captain Crocker, and he was my true hero, and lots of things like that. So Tom called me up and he said, do you want me to be in touch with these guys? This is the first time we've even heard of these people, you know. And it turns out that they were all the guys who were, many of the guys who were in his company in Vietnam. He was a company commander, so he had 120 people that he was managing. Mm-hmm. And so we did, and they invited us to a reunion that year in Omaha, and I went out there with Dave's sister and brother and two brothers, and and they just, when we walked into that hotel, they just embraced us with
how fabulous,
with open arms, and just the storytelling began. They, you know, we spent 3 days just telling stories.
And how wonderful!
Wow,
it was great.
So, what did you do? Did you decide to dig up those letters?
Well, yes. There's a picture. There's even on the trailer. You can see the backhoe.
Yeah.
And that, I guess, a spoiler alert. Actually,
do you not want to talk about that?
We did. No, it's okay. It's all described in the book of what happened. But when we dug them up. It was, I was surprised because even the funeral director who actually helped me to, because everyone thought that a real person was there. So we had to do an official disinterment. He was saying things like, well, you know, it might be the casket is in a vault, and we might have to have a special, you know, instrument to open it up, and we'll have a special machine there. And so I arrive at the cemetery, and, you know, the day after Halloween, and
it's perfect timing.
It's dug up, and down there, here's this concrete slab, and two guys, you know, and they haul the thing out of there, and pull up this coffin, which was Army issue, and creak it open, and everything was destroyed.
Oh my goodness.
Everything. I had laid the letters out. There were about 10 boxes, letter-sized boxes of letters. And then on top of that were, you know, my wedding dress.
The wedding dress, his uniform, right. Whatever.
Pictures, yeah. Photographs. And water had gotten into and then flowed out because it wasn't, there was not water in there, but everything was kind of damp. And I probably shouldn't be telling this, it's the end of the story. But it is still, I mean, this book doesn't end with a big disappointment. I can say that.
Good for you.
It ends, I would say, on a high note.
Good.
That's so good.
Yep.
And it remains to be told to our audience.
Yeah.
So tell me about this book. Now, you wrote this book, and then what happened with this book? This was...
Now, when did you write it? You wrote it after... You dug up the coffin.
I wrote it over a number of years. Some parts of it were written before, and then after the coffin experience, and after meeting these guys and learning their stories, that was when I really felt I needed to write this book, because in this book are their stories too. About their experience in Vietnam, and I think a lot of people of who grew up during this time will understand they'll resonate. You will resonate with this experience that I had, with the war. But the when this kind of thing happens to you, when you lose someone in war or as a result of effects of war, you are automatically a member of a club that you absolutely don't want to be a part of, but you are, because that's who what's happened. And this is the Gold Star Wives, and they are, wonderful people who are survivors of a terrible tragedies, either from losing someone in combat or from the effects of war, like Agent Orange, or all the other things that, basically affected people afterwards for many years. Mm-hmm. And so because of becoming part of that group, and when I'm on the national board of Gold Star Wives, and several of us were invited to the White House in 2014, right after the book was published. And so I had the opportunity to meet President Obama and to present him with my book, which was really wonderful.
Oh, yeah.
The White House is a great place to go. I encourage you, if you get an invitation, to go. It was a great experience.
Yeah.
And I was able to present him and Vice President Biden with a book, and President Obama wrote me a very nice letter afterwards.
He seems like a very gracious man.
He is. Mm-hmm. Very, very gracious.
Mm-hmm.
Very gracious.
I think those of us, I'm from the same generation, born in 44, because we went through so much in a war that was declared not a war for so long, which affected not just during the war, but after the war, the treatment of our returning veterans. I think a positive book, and this is really a positive book, isn't it? Even though it's, it tells about your experience, but I think it's a coming together of shared stories and the memory of a wonderful man.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, I haven't had a chance to get it yet, but I'm going to, because I was going to try to get it before I had you on the show.
I have one for you right here.
Okay. Because I want to read it, because I've lost a lot of people that I knew, not that I was married to, but that I knew in that war. And for us, it was a war. Okay, whether or not you want to declare it officially, right, doesn't matter. For us, we lost a lot of lives.
Well, also, I mean, the people the people who went to war, who were, there were actually 7 women killed in the Vietnam War and more than 58,000 men. And the 7 women who were killed were nurses. So, you know, this was a war of young boys, 18 years old, going to a place that was very inhospitable and suddenly being immersed in a horrendous situation, which they there was no preparation for. You know, the guys told me that, you know, they would be drafted and they might have come from, you know, Minnesota. They're, next day they're in California. They have 3 weeks of training. They're on a plane and suddenly they're in Southeast Asia where it's 110 degrees and humid. Mm-hmm. And then they're out in the, you know, rice paddies mm-hmm. with bloodsuckers and terrible.
Horrible conditions.
And war.
Yeah.
And war.
Yeah. So. A friend of mine was a war correspondent in Vietnam, and he and his wife were there during the war, and his wife was killed shortly after the war before they left. Mm. And it was a bomb that exploded, and he was injured very badly, so he always suffered. And I would hear stories from him over many bottles of beer and glasses of wine that we shared. And it's just, you know, what I think people forget is, not everybody, but a lot of people do forget, is that there are people, human beings, that are proud of our country. And they put their lives on the line for mm-hmm. our country, mm-hmm. to keep us safe. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I see soldiers coming back or leaving at an airport mm-hmm. or bus terminal or wherever and people clap, I think we should always, always do that yeah. because mm-hmm. this is the extreme sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And some of them come back, some of them don't.
But in that war, when soldiers came back, nobody would do that.
No, no.
My ex-husband was in the Vietnam War, and he tells the story when he came back, and he was in an airport, and there was a couple with a couple of little kids, and he went and sat down next to them and said hello, and they just got up and walked away. This is someone who could have gotten killed mm-hmm. fighting yeah. for their freedom, and they couldn't even acknowledge hello.
Yeah, yeah, I've heard that.
They were embarrassed, mm-hmm. you know, they were like,
so that's why this book is so important.
Right.
It's an acknowledgement
right.
of people that, people like that, mm-hmm. your husband, your first husband, put his life on the line, and that's what it cost him,
mm-hmm.
and everyone that loved him, and I can't wait to read it.
Yeah.
I can't wait to read it. So
should we shift to something a little happier? Because I want to ask a question. Tell us about the secret life of Louisa May Alcott.
Oh, okay, that's a shift for you.
Yeah, right. I just kind of segued, but not very well.
Well, actually, when I was working in health administration, mm-hmm. running a nursing home, you know, it's a difficult job in that you're dealing with people at the worst time of
yes.
their life.
Yes.
And people are, it's not like working in a hotel, you know, in the Caribbean where people are happy they're on vacation.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
So I've always done other things that just made me feel like I was balanced, you know. So mm-hmm. at the time, for a period of time, I was doing a lot of singing. And at a certain point, I decided I needed to work on my acting to improve my singing. So I didn't have much time to rehearse with other people, so I decided I would do one-person plays. So I started with Emily Dickinson and did a little play about her. And then Louisa came along as a suggestion from, I was working on my Emily play with a wonderful director, and I happened to be in London And he said, after he saw me do a piece of Emily, the Emily play, he said, you should think about Louisa May Alcott. And so I went back and started to read about her, and she was an amazing person who, she supported her family through her writing. She went to the Civil War and developed typhoid as a nurse, and she developed typhoid pneumonia. They treated them at the time with mercury, so she was only about 30 at that time, and she lived her next about 25 years with all the effects of mercury poisoning, but she wrote.
Wow.
And she wrote, she was an incessant writer. And when it was very difficult for women to be published, this is about 1865, it was very difficult, and but she had, she was writing children's stories, and her editor said, would you write a book about girls? And she said, well, you know, I don't really know very much about girls. I am one, but I don't know very much about them. So he said, well, try. And so she went home, and she churned out Little Women.
I was going to say Little Women, yep.
And Little Women was basically, even though her editor came back with, well, it's kind of boring.
who knew, right?
Wow. He published it anyway, and it was
good.
An unbelievable success. But she, yeah. She was just an amazing person who was a campaigning for women's rights, you know, back during the time of the Civil War, campaigning for votes for women. She was at the time when, after the Civil War, when they would have commemorative events with parades, they would make women basically sit on the ground. Men sat on the grandstand. And Louisa was, this was up in Massachusetts, Louisa was one of the people who basically had a, she had a demonstration against women being, you know, relegated to sit and stand on the ground.
Wow.
So she was amazing. So I wrote a little play about her based on her own work. Mm-hmm. I researched her journals and her diaries, of which there were many, and created a play and performed it wherever someone would ask me to perform. And I performed it all over the place in New York, Florida, all over New England. And was still running the nursing home. So.
A woman of multiple. We need to take a little break, and maybe that's a good
that's
spot.
A good place.
We'll come back to a little bit more on Louisa and a lot more on Ruth Crocker. We'll be right back.
You always made sure I brushed my teeth.
You told me that smart was cool.
You always told me to dream big.
To all of those parents who took the time to make raising their children their most important job, we'd like to say,
thank you.
Thank you.
From the bottom of my heart, thanks, Mom and Dad.
This message is brought to you by the U.S. Air Force.
If you keep tanning, indoors or out, the effects of harmful rays will show up on your skin. Wrinkles, age spots, and an increased risk of melanoma, the second most common cancer in women 15 to 29. Stop tanning. Time may not be on your side. Learn how to protect your skin at spotskincancer.org. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
You'd do anything to take care of that spot on your lawn. So why not take care of that spot on your skin? If you're a man over 50, you're in the group most likely to develop skin cancer, including melanoma, the cancer that kills one person every hour. Check your skin for suspicious or changing spots. Go to spotskincancer.org to find out what to look for. A message from the American Academy of Dermatology.
Oh, hey, bud. Where are you headed?
I'm just gonna hang out.
With Gary and Todd?
Yeah.
I've been meaning to ask you, is there any drinking going on in this crowd?
No.
If any of your buddies ever pressure you to take a drink, just tell them you promised your dad you wouldn't.
I'd do anything to keep you safe.
Okay, I will.
I hope this is working.
I promise. Love you too, Dad.
They really do hear you. For tips on what to say, visit underagedrinking.samhsa.gov.
Welcome back. This is From This Corner TV, and I'm Marilyn Dayton. We have Dodie Millardo co-hosting. We have a wonderful guest, Ruth Crocker. And we've kind of jumped around a little bit from the Vietnam War and her book, and now we're kind of going back to her her acting and her storytelling, if you will. And it all kind of comes together, though, because it's all creative artistry, if you will. And let's talk a little bit more about Louisa May Alcott. We were just saying during the break that I had seen you perform it in a condition that you were not used to, borrowing the lights and everything. But it still was, it was very magical, because we women today respect and love and adore women who take a stand, women who are strong and make a difference. And we were learning a lot about this person, this Louisa May Alcott. What's amazing to me that you shared is that she had lead poisoning in her body, and she still lived another 20-something years, but she was just writing and writing and writing all the time.
Yeah, yeah. The other thing that is incredible about her, which is a lesson for us today as women, is that she didn't, I meet a lot of people who feel very reticent to tell their story or to write a book, and feel that they don't have the gift or whatever it is. And I think Louisa May Alcott demonstrated that, she in those days, she was schooled at home. She didn't have a college education. She was educated by her father, Bronson Alcott. And she just wrote. That's what she did. She just put one word after the other. And when her work was not accepted because she was a woman, she actually wrote under a pseudonym. And she wrote these, for serialized magazines, she wrote these bodice rippers, you know, stories of murder and pillage and, you know, but they were always about strong women who prevailed in the end. So it's really, you know, if someone wants to write, don't let any of the voices in them, they call them, in Buddhism, they call it monkey mind. When you let the voices keep you from doing what you really want to do.
I'm not good enough, and this is not going to be good enough things. Yeah. Just do it.
We all have a story to tell.
Yep.
Right.
And stories are not, people will say to me in classes, oh, my story isn't that interesting. And then they start to tell the story, and it's like riveting.
Yeah, it is.
You know? You cannot judge. If you have a compulsion to write, write. Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about how it comes out. Just put it down.
Because the process of writing is really about revision. So the most important thing is to get it out, and then you have something to work with.
Mm-hmm.
You know that.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You can edit. You can tweak it. You know, you can, yeah, absolutely.
You've got to get it on the page first.
Yeah.
Well, so many people have told me to write books because I've been working since the age of 12 and had a lot of adventures. I've been very blessed. And the first thing I thought of was, yes, I'm a writer. I have a minor in journalism. And I love to write. But when can I sit down and focus on writing a book? So I started writing it in a blog.
Yes.
And each one of my blogs will be a chapter in the book.
Sure.
And it's been well received, and I thought, okay, you know, this is a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's one way of doing it, right? People
that's
can
great.
Write a blog.
That's a great, because you're working in, you're working in segments that you can manage.
Right.
I mean, writing a book is...
That's a lot of time.
If you think, okay, I'm going to sit down and write a book. It's like, all right, I'll climb Mount Everest today.
Yeah, today.
Same thing.
Yeah, exactly. All right, now, do you worry when you write something about other people? Do you worry about how they're going to react to what you're writing? Because in my the book that I wrote, Penelope's Cruise, I do talk about other people, but I've just changed everybody's name and what some of where they were, and I made things happen like to different people than what really the person that really happened to, just to kind of change that and
yeah.
try not to offend, if you will. But what do you think about that?
And yours was a fictional story.
It was fictionalized.
Fictionalized.
Based on a very true story.
Yeah. I think, you know, I think you have to just do it. Just write the story if you feel you have a good story. Mm-hmm. And not worry about what other people are going to think, because usually, it's sort of ironic, but usually the reaction is that people, if you write a book and you've written about several true mm-hmm. story, mm-hmm. and you've written about several people in your life, the people who you leave out are the ones who are going to complain.
Absolutely true.
What about me?
That's a good point. Yeah. That's a really good point.
And maybe that's where it comes from. I told you about a relative of mine that saw one of my blogs, and she said, I hate what you're doing. You're putting our family out in public. You should stop it right now. Did I do that? No. Because I was writing the truth.
Yeah. Well, you're writing your truth.
My truth. Yeah. Yes, my truth.
And you will always have people that come to you and say, well, wait, like my brother. I write about the nursing home, and I write about growing up in that environment. And my brother read it, and he said, it wasn't like that. And I said, well, it was for me.
Mm-hmm.
You're 2 years older. You were living something different. And
right.
you're a boy.
And you're a boy.
And,
right.
and he could write his own version,
that's right? That's right. Good.
Exactly. Yeah. So I don't worry about all those things. And if you are worried about them, write it and then just wait for them all to pass away.
That's a good idea.
Or move somewhere else.
Now, you teach workshops in writing, correct? What kind of things do you tell people and guide people about the writing?
Well, the most crucial thing is to get something down on paper. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if it's a class of people who are really just starting out, mm-hmm. I start with things like writing prompts. You know, even something very simple like, I remember, and then just having people free associate mm-hmm. and just get something down on paper.
Yep.
And then as soon as you've generated enough of those things, mm-hmm. usually something will jump out at you that you remember more about that story.
Mm-hmm.
Then you've got a nugget that you can expand. And I'm sure you found this in writing, that you write the first sort of, you get the first thing down, and then as you're going back into it and reworking on it, you have to always be looking to see if you're writing at a deep enough level. Like, we usually put things down and we're just skimming the surface and we're jumping from one thing to another too quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So learning to slow down,
mm-hmm.
not so much slow the action of the story down, but just slow down in terms of digging deeper into a particular moment. That helps you to begin to really develop your story and find out what the real story is. Because usually when you start to write something, especially a true story, you don't really know the real story until you start to write it and dig into mm-hmm. what it is that you find it. It's like, you know, being an archaeologist in your own brain.
And digging deeper and deeper.
Yeah. It's fun. Yeah. It's really enjoyable.
I've been finding it very fun. I have to be in the mood to sit and write about myself. Mm-hmm. I can write about other people, my clients, and do that work. But to tell my story, I have to be in a reflective mood. Okay. And I found once I started digging, they just kept coming, kept coming, kept coming. And there were stories I was not going to write, like the one, It's a Boy and Then I Died, that one. True story. I wasn't going to write that, but then I did. And my son wrote me an email, and he said, Mom, thanks for coming back for me.
Aww.
Which was, that was important to me, that he understood and got the message.
Yep.
And that's the thing I find. I am my own worst enemy. I'm so critical of myself, my writing, everything I do. I have to get to a point where I say, okay, I accept this. But I still need that approval, if you will, from someone who says to me, wow, I was touched. That to me is like, that's
validation.
All I need.
Yep.
That's all I need.
Yep.
And I think your book has touched a lot of people.
Well, that, you know, doing, I've been with a lot of people in book clubs who've read the book, and it's extraordinary to be with a group of people who have read your story, because everyone brings themselves to the situation. And I think that's what we're doing when we're reading this kind of story, or even with fiction, we're doing that. You know, where that's the sign of it being well written, if someone can just get lost in the story. And so people will come back to me and say, well, I think your book is about this, you know, and or this book is a love story, or this book is a coming of age story. And I'm always so amazed, because I don't think in those terms. I don't think in terms of, not that it's
like categorizing it into something. Yeah.
And so it's extraordinary. And like with your son, you suddenly have a dialogue with someone about something that has been within you for a long time and sort of encapsulated. And then as soon as you put it out there and you're inviting people to share, it's extraordinary.
It is. It's really, it's actually kind of magical.
It is magical.
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm a reader. Every night I read before I go to sleep. I mean, I just love to read. Now let's talk about your main muse, who kept telling you to write.
My main muse, my wonderful son.
Yes.
What do you attribute this wonderful relationship you have with him? What do you attribute that to? Because, you know, some parents, the you know, the relationship with the child is contentious and so forth, and apparently that's not the case at all with him. So what do you attribute how fabulous this relationship is?
Well, you know, Noah was a very extraordinary kid from the beginning, because he was extremely shy with other people. And at home, he was just this very creative, funny, great little person. And so I think that, you know, I think his father, of course, contributed a lot to his growth and development and was a wonderful father. But with this shyness, I became concerned about it, because he was always in the background. So I encouraged him I started having theater workshops where he could try out being someone else. And that was really what transformed him, was when he tells the story himself. I think if you go on Wikipedia, you can read Noah's story. But and because he was a great observer of people, he was a great mimic. And so he just evolved into acting as something very natural and an extension of himself, And I was totally supporting that, totally supporting his, encouraging him to do it. And at the point where he went to college, he was even having questions. Well, you know, if I go and major in theater, I mean, I'm kind of stuck in that. Maybe I should take liberal arts, you know. And I said, Noah, if you love theater, go to a place where you're going to have a kind of conservatory experience, where you're going to be in theater and not just doing it on the side like your mother does, you know, all the time. Do it, you know. And so he did.
Hold up his picture as you're talking about him. Mm-hmm. You're going to recognize this young man. His name is Noah Bean, and he's been on Nikita. He's been on many shows.
Yeah.
And
you can Google him.
You can Google him, yes. And he's wonderful. He's got the talent.
And the David Bowie connection.
And then he, on Vinyl, he played the part of David Bowie. Now, David Bowie, of course, was, slimmer back in those days. But he looked so much like him and had the British accent and everything. I only watched one episode of Vinyl, the one with Noah
in it.
Well, that's also the magic of being an actor is, you know, he had a role that took about 10 minutes in the actual series on HBO, but it was 2 or 3 weeks of work at getting the voice, working with a voice coach, getting the moves, working with a choreographer. Losing weight, watching. Noah said he really didn't even know that much about Bowie during his Ziggy Stardust period, which is what this, where this took place. But, you know, it's research. Actors work really hard. They work very hard at what they do to be totally natural.
To make it look totally natural.
Yeah,
exactly.
You don't realize what goes on behind the scenes to make a movie or a TV series. It's amazing. Yeah.
People don't. Before the show ends, I want to make sure we talk about what's next for
what's
you.
Yes, what's coming.
So if you could hold up this picture and talk about your next project.
This is a wonderful project. A photographer, Steve Horan, had spent about 7 years, the last 7 years, in Yellowstone National Park taking photos, portraits of people who work in and around Yellowstone in all kinds of different jobs, including superintendents and the guy who reintroduced the wolves. And this is Stacy Gerst, who was a wrangler for a summer, a trail guide. And by chance, my older brother is also a Yellowstone Park Ranger.
Oh,
in the
just
summer.
By chance. Interesting. Uh-huh.
So Steve was photographing my brother, and he was complaining to Bob that he didn't have a writer for his project because the last one had quit from... I kind of understand. it's a wonderful project, but it was a lot of work. So basically, he needed someone to interview all these people and write 85 essays to go in this book. And so that's what I did over 3 years was, while I was doing other things, I was doing these interviews
multitasking.
And writing them.
Yes.
And now the book is designed and it's getting ready for publication. And you can go to the website of peopleofyellowstone.com and learn all about it. There's a fundraiser right now to raise money for the production of the book, but it's a wonderful, wonderful. These stories are, for anyone who has any curiosity about Yellowstone or working there or all these things that people do, it's a terrific book. And they're all true stories of real people doing wonderful jobs.
And you expect this book to be out in spring of 2017, is that right?
It'll be out in spring of 2017.
Okay.
Yep. And I just want to say one last thing about Noah as my muse.
Yes.
If it wasn't for Noah, I would never have written this book, finished this book. He was with me the entire process, reading versions of it, and then, you know, supporting me psychologically, artistically, spiritually. So However it is that you can have a wonderful relationship like that with your offspring, I'm just one lucky mother.
Well, you must have done many things right.
Yes, you must have. Yep. And the short movie that talks about this,
the trailer.
The trailer. Yep. He did that, correct?
He did that.
He produced that.
He created
so
it.
So he's got a lot of talents in that department too.
Mm-hmm. Oh yes. Yep.
Wow. Amazing. Yep. This has been so much fun. Mm-hmm. It really has. It's so great
Thank
to
you.
See you again. It's been a while.
Thank you.
The last time we saw each other was in a grocery store, and we talked. this has been amazing. I can't wait to read your book, and I can't wait to get that one.
This one, yeah.
And what I like to do is, well, I like to thank our supporters that help make our program possible. And what I like to do is I like to finish our shows with a quote. And tonight I have two of them. And now you will understand why I picked these two quotes for you. And the first one is from Anne Lamott. You own everything that happened to you. Tell your stories. If people wanted you to write warmly about them, they should have behaved better. We were talking about that.
We were just talking about that.
So
That's right.
Perfect. And then I couldn't resist this one by William Faulkner, who has a lot of interesting quotes. Let the writer take up surgery or bricklaying if he's interested in technique. There is no mechanical way to get the writing done. No shortcut. Teach yourself by your own mistakes. People learn only by error. Now, there must be a story behind that one. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, Dodie, as always. Thank you, Ruth. This has been wonderful. And thank you for joining us, too. And stay tuned for another great From This Corner TV, and we'll see you then. Thank you.